Yeah! I'm so happy that you can get things back and send to my mum.
Of course!
Yeah.
Only a few words. First of all, I'm so delighted to see everybody here. It is so exciting. I can't believe that I wrote the book anymore. But and also people in my life. There are people that are here that are in the book as well. So thank you very much for coming. And my dear family, who I've given so much admiration to people even this morning. But everyone's here, except that one or two performers are not here yet, but they're on the way. So what we're going to do is we're going to have some readings and some music that kind of goes with the songs, all right? And I thank all of you for coming, and especially those who are in the book, because without you, we wouldn't have had a book. I can't start this without mentioning two people who died recently who were real inspiration to me as people, and both wrote so beautifully. And one was Uyadneri and the other was Amzos. So really at this time when it was so near to when they passed away that I have to think about them because they were very inspirational, especially Amos was. I wanted to say that I want to say that when I wrote the book, it wasn't a book, it was just stories. I was just writing stories about what happened to me after my husband died, because everything changed. I was married to one man for 60 years. He was wonderful and marvelous. He was very sick and he was really all the hard times, but he was fantastic till the end, and he was compos mentis till he died, so I had that too. And when he went, there was a very, very big gap. And it was a question of what do? Turn into a miserable old lady or get on with life? So the book more or less is my search for what to do to fill up the time. Not all of it, but most of it is that. And the other day I was asked to speak at Tel Aviv University. There was a group of social workers and they wanted someone to talk about Bididut, who was a issues skeinar, a little bell Bididut. I've been alone, been isolated, and one of the social workers had met me when I was isolated with a broken leg, and so she gave my name, and so they phoned me and said, would you come and speak? And I said, oh, that's funny, I've just written a book about that. And so I turned up, and they were sitting in a group, you know, now it's a fashionable thing to have a round table thing, and they started the thing, and I said, look, I'm not staying for this session, but if you want me to speak, I'll speak now. And it really is the book. It's, you have to do something with your life. You can't just let people be alone. You have to find something. And one of the biggest things I found was dancing. So there's quite a lot about dancing in the book. And the other thing was meeting a lot of people, mostly younger than me, which also made a fantastic difference. So please, Hagit, my darling Hagit, is going to open with a surprise for me.
I'm very excited. No, I want to speak in English after practice. Okay. It's like a muscle, if you don't practice, it goes away. I love you. I'm proud of you, and you are a big inspiration for me. And what I wanted to do, even you asked for a song, I have this startup called the Songs and Messages, and I want you to just close your eyes and pick up song.
I imagine one? Oh, okay.
Okay, listen. No, it's believable.
I think I do it. They're all the same, the colors.
No, they are not the same. Well, when I come to a event like this, I think about, okay, who the people are going to be there and what kind of songs I'm going to put that they will choose. And I put some in Hebrew, some in English, and with the song that Zelda won from the beginning. And I said, if she's going to choose a song, this is going to be the song, she can choose that one. She chose a song that I would never think to sing, but
Lucky.
So, Meet Gilad, this is very spontaneous. We just met and I like it. I like surprises.
But you play, you're gonna play too.
Yes. Oh, okay.
You can play then.
Okay.
If not, just pretend.
Improvising.
Is there gonna sing? You sing? I'm not singing though.
I will sing, don't worry. Maybe not. Just a perfect day. Drink sangria in the spark. And later when it gets dark, we go home. Just a perfect day. Feed animals in the zoo. And later a movie too. And then a it. Your back of your head chose the song, and I would never think about it. So it's a perfect day to celebrate with you, and I wish you perfect days.
Okay, now it's my turn. Well, this is this story. This is like a site-specific event because the site is flat. Is where the story happens. So it's actually, the drama is happening in the real place. And it's also self-referential because it's referring to me. And really a story about Zelda and myself.
And Ben.
And Ben, who is in Thailand, but the side that is not the stormy side right now. It just landed now, more or less. It's called I Enter My Flat. I enter my flat, all the lights are on. That's odd, I think to myself. It was daylight when I rushed out of the house for a lecture in Givatayim. So who would put the lights on? This was Zelda speaking. I hate Givatayim. Even when I had a car, I could never find my way around it. By bus, it's even worse. At Tel Aviv Central Station, I descend from the 42 bus and ask the driver if he knows how I can get to there. He kind of nods, points his finger, and following his directions, I eventually arrive at the designated bus stop. I ask a young couple standing there if they know where Yavni Eli Street is. The man immediately gets out his mobile phone and, using Move It app, tells me exactly how to get there. The bus arrives, I alight and ask a woman sitting in the front seat if she knows where Yavni Eli is. She looks at me blankly And then another passenger tells me, it's off Khorasim Street. A woman standing nearby butts in. It's five stops and then a 400 meter walk. At this point, I feel like turning around and heading home. I finally arrive at my destination. I fumble in my bag for money to pay the entrance and unwittingly press on my mobile, which then emits a weird kind of barking sound. I take it out, and there on the screen I see emergency call. I think nothing of it and turn off the mobile. The lecture ends, and a really nice woman offers me a ride home. What a relief. On the way back, I check my phone. My son has called me several times. No messages, though. He must be worried about where I am, I guess. Once in the lit-up flat, I try his mobile. Mummy, where are you? He yells. I'm home now. Why? You sent me three messages saying I need help, he retorts. What? I reply. I did no such thing. At which point he says, stay where you are, I'm coming. A few moments later, he and my grandson Ben walk through the door accompanied by a policeman. I'm sitting at the kitchen table in my nightie having a late supper. What the hell? They bid farewell to the policeman and thanked him profusely. We've been searching for you for hours, says my son. Four policemen have been helping us. We managed to trace you to give a time. When we first came to the flat, Ben noticed that you had marked a venue and give a time on your calendar. And the police said the emergency call came from that location. Then it all became clear, including the reason for the lights being on in the flat. I was horrified to think what my family must have gone through. I saw the message on my son's phone, help me. Now I know for sure that I am indeed a burden and can't be trusted to go out at night alone. What a liability I have become, independent me. What have I done to my precious family? Who would not think the worst on receiving such a message, and several times? I hate this new phone. I bought it under pressure in Dynamic at Canyon Ayalon. I want to make a public complaint against the guy who sold it to me without a proper explanation of how to use it and without any written instructions in English. Previously, when I purchased a Doro phone for old people, a representative came to my home and gave a simple and clear explanation. After all, the idea of a phone suitable for seniors that provides security at the touch of a button in the event of an emergency was a good one. No? I'd just like to add. Ben and I spent 2 hours in the back of a police car, behind the grill, you know, where the criminals sit, going around Kibatang, looking for her. And the phone kept ringing from the Tel Aviv Police Department. Kibatang Police Department, have you found her yet? Do you know where she is? And we're at the back of this thing in the cage. There she is in her 90s. And another thing she said was, what a gorgeous policeman. In United.
My name is Gilad Chatzav, nice to meet you. I will accompany you.
My sleep, make me
knows everything about me.
5 years later, we
said, time in Moscow really made us very close.
Jane, we can't hear you.
I'm sure we'll hear in five minutes.
I'm exhausted yet. All right, so just a minute. I've got to find it.
Is dating ever worth it? My friend's father is on his own. Would you like to meet him? Shira sounded encouraging. Everyone knows that for the past 3 years, I've been hoping to find a male companion. Can you hear?
Yes.
Though rarely has anyone made the effort in my direction. A few days later, however, the phone rang. Are you the Berit Zelda? A well-modulated voice speaking English. Probably a salesman, I thought. My name's Shmuel. I received your number from a mutual friend and would like to meet you. He suggested that we meet at the fashionable Ganhaim Mall at 11 a.m. as he lived in the area. He told me he would wait for me near the Evan Taylor supermarket, and I readily agreed, knowing that there was a wonderful Hungarian patisserie nearby. I'll be wearing red corduroy trousers, he said.
This is your daughter set me up with this guy.
It was easy to spot him. He was short, sporting a raunchy cap, glasses, reefer jacket, and the aforementioned trousers. He greeted me with a big smile. I'm Shmuel. I looked into his strained blue eyes that once must have twinkled. After telling me that his sight was deteriorating, he then said, but I can see that you have beautiful hair and a great figure. He sat down, a waitress approached us. Not just yet, he said, and waved her away. Shmuel, who must have been quite a lad in his younger days, had survived a lot of his famine in the Holocaust, arrived in Eretz Yisrael alone on an immigrant boat which had defied the British occupiers. After enlisting with the British forces and serving in Egypt and Italy, he joined Etzel. His wife, who had been 10 years his junior, was, according to Shmuel, sexy, beautiful, and a woman who loved life. As an egged bus driver, he had flexible hours, and he told me that he had done all the household chores for her, as she was totally involved in her work. Except for a few affairs on the side, he'd been an exemplary husband. His faded eyes at the thought. He then went on to boast about their lifestyle, their shared interest in opera and classical music, traveling to exotic climes and so on. I didn't have anything as romantic and exciting in my life. I thought that perhaps this would turn into a fortuitous experience. I hinted that I would be happy to go to concerts with him, and that I too love traveling. An hour and a half later, after he had heard my life story, I said with a parched voice, can I have a drink? The desire for a cup of coffee overwhelmed me, and I anxiously peered around looking for the waitress who had been rebuffed by him a couple of times. I eyed a guy at the next table, forking into a delicious-looking Danish pastry, and my mouth watered. Shmuel didn't ask me what I would like, but ordered hot milk for himself, and I ordered a café hafouch. I anticipated that he would ask if I wanted something to eat, but he didn't. I was too much of an English lady and sat there politely, although I was beginning to seethe. We sat for what seemed another eternity, hints about his exciting sex life and so on. Then I glanced at my watch. It was almost 2 o'clock. I felt as though my stomach had become detached from my brain, so I got up and said I had to leave. What's the hurry? He asked. I have to prepare some things at home. and have arrangements for the evening, so I need to rest. Who are you going to rest with? He said. Alone, I muttered. What did he think? I had a toy boy? Suddenly there flashed across my eyes a picture of his false teeth and mine lying next to each other in the bathroom. I thought about how attractive and daring he must have been once. And I know about short men, their massive egos and sex drives, which compensate for their lack of height. A close friend who was not tall once admitted to me that inside him was a tall man desperately trying to get out. Schmall insisted on escorting me to the bus, holding on to my arm. The bus arrived, I bent down slightly, pecked him on the cheek and climbed onto the bus. Shearer called me later that day. How was it? I admitted that he was lively in his way, young at heart maybe, but not of limb. He was stingy, so decidedly not for me. She burst out laughing, then realised how affronted I was. I told her not to feel guilty, as I would have fun writing a blog about it. Over time, having given it some thought, it's possible that I had perhaps been too standoffish. Then do you want me to, there's another one, Zelda, but you said stop there. I think the next one's even worse.
I just asked everyone, do you know of a man I go to theatre with, walks on the beach? I didn't want much, I didn't want money or anything, I wanted just something.
Yet haunting sound of a cello rings through the dance studio of Kibbutz Tovar, perched on the hills of the lower Galilee, ringed by a necklace of green foliage and topped by a clear blue sky. I follow the sound, open a door, and gently slide to the floor. He sits, facing the view, hunched over a cello, caressing it almost as if an embrace with a lover. He slides the bow from right to left. The studio resonates with a magnificent sound. Sometimes it's only a whisper, his hand so lightly on the bow. Sometimes sonorous tones which cause me to tremble. He is totally impervious to my presence. When I first encountered him in a dance class, he was reserved to the point of being unfriendly, certainly unavailable as a dance partner. Preferred to move his body to the music without interruption from any other living soul, content in his personal space. Yet now, he is now providing me with this sublime musical experience. He is communicating with nature, communing with nature, oblivious to the other members of our dance group. They are busy in the kitchen with the mundane preparation of food, or sitting chatting in the break from our intensive sessions on the dance floor. The sounds from the touch of his bow and the cello strings. Arouses within me a passion that leaves me breathless. A solo performance for an audience of one. The music reaches a crescendo. The rising and falling of the notes from loud to almost violent and then to gentle moaning. The artist is immersed in his creation. I want to tell him that he needs to get back to the group, that there's a session about to begin, though I dare not shatter the supreme moment. At last, he brings the bow to rest on a whisper. I clap, and he is startled. I gently ask him to tell me the name of the piece he played, and he had his answer. It was just an improvisation, simply an expression of how I was feeling. I sigh, and turn as if in a trance toward the studio while the others were warming up. Nemekitipa is playing. I do not see him enter. We're asked to find the partner close by. I look up and see him. He nods his head. I'm in my flimsy Indian cotton dress, and he in a green t-shirt and loose pants. We start to dance, shoulder to shoulder, worldless, wordless. We are many years apart in age, but our bodies speak and we become as one, exploring our senses, giving and receiving through touch and movement. Never before have I experienced such pure bliss on the dance floor. It was as if no one else was there. Truly, rhythms of the heart. Thank you. Thank you.
Specializing in holistic tours for those interested in body and mind. For 4 days, beginning our travels in Colombo, Sri Lanka, we visited temples and gave floral offerings to the gods, so the gods would be good to us. We learned about why so much salted dried fish was on sale at the port, and we didn't say why, by the way. And as we toured,
they couldn't preserve it any other way.
No. And as we toured, our mobile cameras did not stop shooting the carved figurines in lustful poses on the magnificent buildings we passed. We finally arrived in Wadawa.
That's how you say it?
Wadwa at the Siddhalepa Ayurveda. Ayurveda.
Those are big, sorry.
Well, it's a health resort where we were to enjoy 6 days of treatment. Notice six and six.
Six days.
The spa was situated within a tropical forest on a white sandy beach, which stretched for miles and was hardly inhabited by a soul. I could enter the vast ocean as if I owned it, because no one was around and few other guests were drawn to it. There was not even a lifeguard. Only the young lads from the Scandi village next to the sumptuous spa were occasionally found playing around in the water with a makeshift boat. They paid me no mind. Each day after breakfast, we checked in with the doctor, and for the rest of the morning, luxuriated in oil-centered treatments, pools filled with herbal leaves and sensual massages. In the evenings after dinner, the group would get together for a chat or a lecture. So, one evening before dinner, a Buddhist monk addressed us, following which Moran, our female group leader, who was steeped in Buddhism, invited us to sit with her. For over an hour, she spoke intimately about how we could get more enjoyment out of zugyut, relationships. She began by suggesting drinks other than alcohol, which could arouse your partner's libido. Warm milk with honey was one option. She also mentioned aphrodisiac foods, including avocado. She suggested touching, breathing, and playfulness, snuggling, and whispering into your partner's ear while lying on the couch watching TV. Why am I sitting here listening to all this with neither a man nor a woman partner, I asked myself. So I got up, quietly slipped away, and went back to my deluxe spa room with a king-sized bed large enough for three. I sobbed my heart out in the shower. I always buy those mini bottles of vodka they sell at the airport, and in fact had bought nuts too, thinking that I could invite some other members of the group for a drink before dinner. But they were not that kind of crowd, so it didn't happen. I squeezed some oranges, which I had taken from the breakfast table, added vodka, and lay on the bed feeling very sorry for myself. I summoned up some Dutch courage, slapped on some makeup, and went out for dinner. After the meal, we all sat around a small decorated pool, dipping our toes into the water. In this romantic atmosphere, the palm trees swayed whilst the full moon in a deep blue sky shone down upon us. Moran happened to be sitting at my side. She whispered to me, "How did you find my lecture?" I told her my thoughts under no uncertain terms. I'll just say, "How did you find my lecture?" I told her my thoughts in no uncertain terms. She looked at me quizzically. "You must learn to love yourself." "I heard that somewhere before." I replied, flabbergasted, "What? I do." "No," she said, "I mean, make love to yourself. There are all kinds of sex toys you can buy. After you masturbate with a false penis, believe me, you will feel great. You have absolutely no idea." I stammered, "I can't, I never could, that doesn't work." "Try," she insisted. Then she leaned closer and said, "I know a wonderful sex therapist, and I can give you his name." I looked at her in amazement. "Am I hearing correctly? You're suggesting I pay someone to make love to me?" Thoughts raced through my brain. How much would it cost? And it's like, how often would I need to go? Those are the questions I ask myself. Well, actually, how come I never thought of that before? What a great idea. Okay. "I'll give you his number," she said softly, in confidence. Well, since then. Was she serious? Is she still waiting for my call? Well, I haven't got the guts or nuts or the money. I guess it's at least several hundred shekels a far. So I guess I am destined to be alone with my fantasies and my dancing, and that's only place I get my cakes. It was a great holiday, though.
And I have been friends by chance, another one in my life, when she was waitressing as a student at Tel Aviv University, and she brought me a cup of coffee. And I said, "Where are you from?" From that moment, we have been really good friends, and she's made a fantastic career for herself in the time that I've been messing around writing books and doing things.
Thank you. השיר הזה זה כאילו על החבר שלי שפשוט נוסע הרבה ברחוב ממני, כל הזמן אומרת ברחוב ממני, ואי דאמרת. אז זה ממש געגועים שלי, זה חבר שלי.
Easily high.
don't have much money, but boy, if I did, I'd buy a big house where we both could live. If I was a sculptor, but then again, no, or a man who makes potions in a traveling show. I know it's not much, but it's the best I can do. My gift is my song, and this one's for you. And you can tell everybody this is your song. It may be quite simple, but you're in the world.
And many of the people are in the stories. So.
Can I say one more
yes,
thing?
Please.
I just want to say. I'm an artist and a feminist activist, and and I have a lecture called "Why I Love Men and Hate War." So just men can calm down. They also have to get the bag and another stick. Anyhow. But I wanted to say that what for me is really special is that Zelda talked to me long years ago about wanting to write and wanting to write, and I said yes, 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 and one of the reasons because the voices of women, as we know, like we're bringing them back, and the voices of women of certain ages are still kind of put back, and the voices of women who still admit to having a sexuality are in a certain age are really kind of still a taboo. So this for me is a huge breaking of taboo, and I'm so happy you did it.
Yeah, but it did. Woo!
Okay, the muses are known to be also our lovers,
yes.
Right? So.